want a little bit of the shine that you got, or they want to take a little bit of shine away from you, don't let it happen. Because all they're really trying to do is try to find out where you are, because they're mad because they're not there. A lot of times, people in our lives, Christian, sometimes it's other Christians, isn't it? Man, you know, this guy went to church, he brought his whole family there, and after church, he criticized everything. He said, man, that piano player stinks. That pastor, he doesn't have anything good going on. Those ushers were mean. And little Timmy, his little son, said after the service, I don't know, Dad, but when those plates came around, we got all that and it only cost you a quarter. You know, some of the people who are the biggest critics are the worst ones, and some of those people are Christians themselves who are so caught up on the things of the world that they're trying to twist things that are really worldly and aren't scripturally and trying to mess it up for the rest of us. All I'm saying to you tonight, don't let it be messed up, but you know what you got to do? Three things, and I'll be finished tonight. Three things you got to know in order for this not to happen. We got to know, and we got to listen and pay attention to the question that God is asking us. We got to make sure we don't make excuses for what God is asking us to do, and then we got to make sure we don't let other people or Satan or our own flesh confuse us. So the three things we must do is we got to know our Bible. It's not enough just to, can I come down here? I'm going to just listen. It's not enough for us just to read our Bible. We got to study our Bible. The Bible says, meditate therein day and night. Study to show thyself approved. Just read it. Now, you know you've read 10, 11 chapters and forgot everything that you just read before in your life. Let's be honest here. We've got to make sure that we study and we know it so that when somebody tries to trick us with our own word, the revelation of God to men, that we can say, no. That ain't in there. People always say, well, God will never give you more than you can handle. It's not what it says. The Bible says that he'll make a way to escape out of those things. It doesn't say that you're just not going to have some days where you feel like you've had too much on you that you can handle. It's not what the word of God says. You got to be very, very careful with the things that are in here. Number two, you got to remember this. Listen to the men that God and the people that God has put in your life who are godly. See, I can follow Pastor McInerney and I can work for him because he's a godly man. He has a godly family. And I know that everything he taught me came from the word of God, and it wasn't just his opinion. Amen. We are so caught up today in our world listening to other people's opinion that we forget that the only opinion that matters is the one that's in between this text. Hey, if you got a cell phone tonight, that's cool, but I would say this to you. There's no text message more important than the one that God sent through his son, Jesus Christ. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word is God. This Bible is God in text. I'm just saying to you tonight, if you don't read and study your Bible, you're missing it. And if you don't listen and you don't follow Christ because he follows Christ, so you can follow this pastor because he follows Christ. If you don't hear, you know that people are afraid of this and they get kind of weird when you say this. But do you know that your pastor, do you know that we are prophets of God? It just means we are messengers. God has a special calling on our life that he talked to us to convey his word. And so when we preach this word, what it is we are God's messengers telling you what God wanted us to tell you so that you can know what to do. Amen. That's what it is. So it's very important that you follow those people that have been put in your life, placed in your life. Young folks, if you have a Sunday school teacher, if you have somebody that's been trying to help you and counsel you through the word of God, know what's in here so that you can make sure that you can really trust them and follow. And number three tonight, the greatest way, my opinion, it's not really opinion, it's the Bible. The greatest way to follow Jesus, to pay attention, to be made completely whole, to live your life a living sacrifice, is to be very sensitive to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Bible says the Holy Spirit is the teacher. He'll cause all things that come to your remembrance. Listen. The Holy Spirit of God will cause all things to come to your remembrance. You know what that means? It's the scripture. You ever been at the grocery store and you want to tell somebody about Jesus, but you don't think you're going to remember what to say? But see, that's an excuse. If you just go on and say, well, you know, my name is John and I want to tell you about Jesus, the Holy Spirit will give you what you need to say. But the only thing is, you got to have it hidden in your heart in order for him to bring it out. You ever taken a test and you know you don't know the answers? Someone just said, oh yeah, that was you asked. Yeah, I did that. And you get there and it's time for test time and you go, and you get into that method of multiple choice where you just start going A, C, D, B, C, A, C, B, C, and you just go back and forth because you know you don't know the answers. The Bible has all the answers you'll ever need. And then when it's time for the test to talk to somebody, the Holy Spirit will bring it out for you. You don't even have to really take the test. You just have to listen. The Holy Spirit of God, He is God. Sometimes He's left out. We sang holy, holy, holy. Why do you think there's three holies? Because God the Father is holy, God the Son is holy, and the Holy Spirit. His name is Holy Spirit. Come on now. He's holy. And sometimes we leave Him out and we forget about Him, but He's indwelled in every single one of us that are saved, and we have Him, and He'll guide us, and He'll push us through. And everything that we do, every decision we make, goes through the filter of the Holy Spirit. My mama used to ask me questions like this. Would you take God there with you? Oh, mama, no, I wouldn't do that. Is this where you want to be when Jesus comes back? Oh, Lord, no, mama, no. That's not a good place for me. That's not a good look, mom. No. You got to make sure that the Holy Spirit is in you, that you remember every place you go, everything you do, God's riding shotgun. Everywhere you go, when you're riding in your car, nobody's over there. Yeah, there is. Look over like, what up, Holy Spirit? He's with you. And He's going to help you, and He's going to tell you. He was the original GPS. We don't know where we're going in Savannah, so I'm on my phone, GPS and everything. And I might have a little too much faith in that machine, but it's gotten me everywhere I want to go. But I believe so strong that the Holy Spirit said, you know what, we're not going to have any interference here. No navigational problems with the wiring or anything that could go on in the air or the satellite. We're going to have everything work out because this is where you're supposed to be at this time. Amen. The Holy Spirit of God, He will help you. You can trust in God. See, this man, he knew that he was made whole because he'd been there before. He'd been down. He'd been discouraged. He'd been hurting. He'd been laying at this pool, unable to do whatever it is that his infirmity was, apparently something about not being able to move. But let me just show you this and we'll be finished. Back here in verse 6. When Jesus saw him lie, what's it say there? Would you say it out loud? And knew. Jesus knows you better than you know yourself.
Amen.
Listen to me, Christian. I know you're saved, but this doesn't say anything. Listen to me. This doesn't say anything about the man being saved. It says he was made whole. He had a physical impairment. I'm not saying that he did get saved. It would imply that he did. I'm just saying to you, you know that you were lost and now you're found. You were not whole because you lacked the Spirit of God until you got saved and gained the Spirit of God and made that third part of what makes a man a man. And what happens here is, though, Jesus knows you. So you don't have to worry so much. You don't have to do. Sometimes we as Christians, we get down and discouraged on ourselves when we start to make excuses because we think that we did something so wrong. But you know that Jesus knows you better than you know yourself. Jesus knows, Christian. Now, I'm just going to point it out here tonight. Every single person in this room, I believe this, because the Apostle Paul himself had a thorn in the flesh that never went away as far as we know. But God told him, my grace is sufficient for thee. So I believe, this is my belief, allow me to liberty tonight, that every Christian has a little something wrong with them. I'm looking at some of you, and some of you have a little bit more wrong with you than others. Amen. But we all got something. Whether it be a sin issue, you know, I broke my hip when I was 14 years old, and so I hold on my thigh a little bit. I walk a little funny. I'm not as spiritual as Jacob in the Bible, but I like to use that scripture as an analogy that I wrestled with God and God truly won. And so I hold on my thigh a little bit, but it never has stopped me from doing what God wants me to do. Now listen, you might have a little something wrong with you tonight, but Jesus knows that. Is he not God? Did he not know what was wrong with this man? Did he not heal this man? Did he not make it okay for this man? Apparently the man was up walking, and guess what he was doing? He was witnessing. He was telling them what Jesus had done for him. All I'm saying to you tonight here, you have, and I, we have no excuse. We have no excuse to get up, rise up, take up our bed, be made whole, then go and tell other people about what Jesus Christ, who knows you better than you know yourself, has done for you. over and over and over again. Because the Bible never says that we should stop witnessing. It doesn't matter if you're 5 years old or if you're 105. The Bible says that we continue a living sacrifice. So you know what that means? As long as you have air in your lungs, as long as you have a heartbeat, as long as you have something you can do, that we are supposed to be witness for Jesus Christ. All the time. Everywhere. Is God good? Is Jesus Christ the Savior of the world? Is Jesus able to make us whole?